Es mágico. Son animales tremendos. Digamos que lo que es emocionante es, pues, como verlos la primera vez. Las fotos no son muy buenas, pero me recuerdan, casi de todas recuerdo el momento en que la tomé. Mira esta. Es divino. Esta es de las fotos que más me gusta. Hace como 5 años empecé a verlo. Y hoy en día están estos, pero más grandecitos. Se ve perfecto aquí. Mi nombre es Jorge Julián Santos. En caficultura, en este terreno, hemos estado desde 1965. Yo no me podría imaginar en mi vida otra cosa que cultivo el café, principalmente por el modo en que se hace aquí, que es bajo sombrío. Eso me apasiona, que sea con sombrío y que haya biodiversidad. Lo que realmente me apasiona del café es solamente la planta, la cultura, los árboles, el suelo y el sabor. Nada más.
In Colombia, coffee is an essential part of our culture. I grew up, as most Colombians, where coffee was present during the morning, afternoon, and evenings. It is a ritual.
One of the most fascinating things about coffee is that it's grown in some of the biggest biodiversity hotspots on the planet. When coffee is grown sustainably, it provides spaces for all of those unique forms of life. However, birds have been going through steep population declines. As habitat worldwide is transformed into agricultural or urban land uses, there's less and less habitat available for birds. Since the 1970s, 3 billion birds have been lost from North America. That's an overwhelming number. It really is a conservation crisis. When we think about what we can do for these species, it's finding ways to bring those birds back. If we don't succeed, we risk potentially the extinction of many of these migratory bird species. One of the reasons migratory birds are declining is that agriculture is rapidly intensifying. This is a process that started in the 1970s, where government programs really promoted removing all native vegetation from coffee farms to have higher productivity. That process essentially eliminated all of the habitat for migratory birds on coffee farms.
En esta finca, mi padre empezó con la caficultura porque era económicamente viable. Las primeras siembras importantes que hizo en café sin sombrío. El clima y el suelo exige que haya un sombrío para bajar la intensidad solar y para proteger principalmente el suelo de esos rayos, para proteger los microorganismos. Todo el trabajo, pues, que hago, lo hago principalmente por una necesidad de tener un mejor ambiente, un mejor productividad. Que el café y que el suelo esté en su lógica de vivir en armonía, eso lo llena de satisfacciones, de vida, de animales, de mariposas, de insectos, no solamente en las cañadas, sino en todo el área. Que a cualquier caficultor lo tiene que llenar de alegría.
The movement towards more trees in coffee farming landscapes is very exciting. But at the same time, in other landscapes, coffee is still a primary driver of deforestation. Sometimes it is horrifying to think about the amount of land that's been converted from native habitat to a sun-grown coffee farm. Those systems are at risk for drought, for heavy rainfall, but there are still some farms, like the one we're standing on today, that have chosen to actively conserve the tree species that were originally found here. Finding the right solution for coffee farmers, coffee companies, really depends on where specifically that coffee comes from. On one scale, we're working with individual farms, trying to understand what can one farmer do to make their farm better for birds and biodiversity. But we also know that individual farms fit into landscapes, and each landscape we work in has a different composition. Some farms have a ton of forest retained on the landscape. Others are primarily deforested, and the shade over the coffee is one of the only natural vegetation types left to birds. We are working to give recommendations, not to just individual farmers, but to municipal governments, to coffee companies, so that together we can create a landscape that's providing spaces for all of the birds that live here. Without coffee farmers that have chosen to maintain these trees, there is no habitat for these migratory birds.
Mi pasión empezó más con los árboles, más con el hábitat que con la especie. Para mí lo favorito es que no todos sean de la misma especie, aunque para las aves sí uno encuentra que cada una tiene su especie favorita. Desde el principio que empecé, ¿por qué es importante el guamo? Porque me aporta al suelo. No, también le aporta a unas aves, también le aporta a unos insectos. Mira, todo esto aporta. La vida lógica de mi finca, de mi área.
This farm is a good place for birds. Starting a coffee farm like this one will allow us to understand how those birds use shade-grown coffee. You have different habitats for birds to find food, to find refuge, to breed, to refuel before migration. In the end, we want to recommend a set of trees that are best for attracting the most diversity of birds and insects. We have realized that it is important to have different species with different structures. There are some tree species, relatively small, that can be really, really attractive to many species. It acts like a bridge, then they will come down, and it's more likely that they will just start foraging inside the coffee shrubs. And we want to attract those species because many of those species will end up eating pests of coffee plants. That would be really good for coffee producers. We were really surprised when doing a preliminary analysis of the data, because fig trees are visited not only when the tree is offering fruit or flowers, but even when the tree has no flowers or fruits, they are visited by loads of birds. Fig trees are a three-star restaurant for everyone. They are key for the whole bird community, and that is really something exciting to find out. By attracting different birds, you are benefited by all the different ecosystem services that birds can provide. Pollinating, dispersing seeds, eating crop pests.
Espectacular ver árboles y árboles y árboles que cualquiera pensaría que es un bosque, inclusive natural, y saber que debajo están esas plantas de café produciendo una buena cantidad de café lo llena uno de satisfacción. Siempre estoy con mis binóculos. Todo lo más interesante, en esta época del año, las migrantes están aquí. Estoy viendo una cantidad de animales que además son espectaculares.
Many of the migratory birds I see in my backyard in the United States are here right now because it's the winter. Even though these species are really common, we still don't know how the quality of habitat on this coffee farm affects their breeding success. So some of the research we're conducting is putting on little radio trackers and following them in their migration back to the United States and Canada, and then back down here next year to Colombia. We're setting up the net poles right now. They're very lightweight but strong nets, and as birds are just flying through this area, they'll hit the net and fall into these bags. it's pretty safe for birds as long as there's a qualified crew that knows what they're doing that can come and extract them right away. The goal is to tag them and have them live for many years in the future so we can continue to study them. So we're really conscious about how we're installing the mist nets, how we're extracting birds, and how we go through the process of putting on harnesses. So the mist net's open now. As you can see, you can't really see it anymore, so we're just gonna leave this here. Birds will fly into it and we'll take them out as they hit. We have a male summer tanager in the tree right above us. This particular male, we've been trying to catch now for about 2 hours, but he hasn't yet crossed where we have the net. I'm not sure if we're gonna be able to catch him. We got something. Oh. Yes. We just caught an adult male summer tanager. Nick is gonna take it out of the net right now and take it down to our banding station. We're going to band the bird, we're going to weigh it, we're gonna take its body condition, and then we're going to put a transmitter on its back. The tags will last through spring migration and through fall migration, so we'll know if they come back to this same site. Very soon it's gonna take off for the United States, leaving this coffee farm. Understanding how migration works, where specific birds go, is critical so that we can ensure the survival, not just of critically endangered or threatened species, but also the really common species that are going through population decline. By studying migratory species on this farm, that helps us make recommendations for coffee farmers, but also for coffee industry that is actively paying farmers more for their coffee if it's grown in sustainable ways. And that's really where there's power in our research to scale conservation action across coffee growing landscapes. For the first time, we have interest from all of the different people across a coffee supply chain in making coffee production more biodiversity friendly. There's interest on the exporter and importer community, and then we're seeing increased interest from coffee roasters and consumers who want to know that their coffee came from a landscape that's actively conserving biodiversity instead of harming it. The best thing a consumer can do is actively look for coffees that are conserving biodiversity. Your choice of your daily cup of coffee really matters. I would really hope that all of us just take a moment drinking that morning cup of coffee to appreciate the coffee farmers that are growing it, the families that will continue to manage these lands, and the birds that sing above the coffee as it's grown.
Esta finca, esta familia, y esta área, ejemplo de bienestar ambientalmente, tanto para microorganismos, aves, plantas, como para la gente. Si logramos los cafeteros aprender sobre el tema, vamos a tener una caficultura por muchísimas y muchísimas y muchísimas décadas más. Todos hacemos parte de la cadena, desde el consumidor, en Nueva York, en Tokio, en donde ustedes quieran, desde esa persona hasta el que la produce, estamos unidos. Eso sí es el orgullo, realmente.